In this video, we're going to look at 10 differences between two of the most popular threads for hand stitching leather. And those threads are going to be the Tiger thread, or Ritza 25, and the Lin cable thread, the Fio Chinois. So if you've not used either of those threads, or you've used one and you're thinking about trying the other, then this will give you some information that you can use to make a decision as to what you might want to try out next. So first of all, let's talk about the companies that make these threads before we start looking at the differences. So Tiger thread, or Ritza 25, is made by a company called Julius Koch. They are based in, I think they're originated in Denmark, and I think they're now based in kind of Denmark and Germany. So they're a European company. They were founded in 1895, so they're quite an old company. And as a company, they are somewhat of a frustration to me, because although the thread is excellent, and it's the thread that I mainly use, the company themselves are somewhat closed off to the public. So they won't, for example, sell directly to the public. They're very much obviously a large manufacturer, and then they deal with resellers who sell on the thread. So they're not what you would call really accessible in terms of dealing directly with the company. Conversely, the French thread, the Lin cable, they're made by a company called Maison Sajou, which is based in Paris. Again, that's an old company from the 1800s. And I believe what happened with Maison Sajou was that the company ran from the early 1800s, I think it was 1842, up to around the 1950s. I'm not quite sure what happened with the company, but I believe the company kind of lapsed, I think, and then it was relaunched over 10 years ago now, I think in around 2005. They brought the brand back, the products back, and that's now going from strength to strength again as a modern company now. So Maison Sajou, they have a physical shop in Paris. I've never actually been to Paris, but if you're in Paris, they have a physical shop you can go in where you can buy the thread. They have a website which of course sells all the thread and ships worldwide, and then there are obviously people who sell the thread on as resellers as well. So in terms of accessibility, you can shop and deal directly with the company themselves, and that's in contrast to Julius Koch. They're a little bit more accessible in that way. Okay, that's the actual companies. So let's get on looking at the 10 differences between the threads, because there are some significant differences between these. Okay, so first of all, let's talk about the composition of the two threads. In other words, what the threads are actually made of, because that's very important and that affects a lot of the other aspects of the thread. So Tiger thread is a braided polyester thread. Polyester is a man-made material, and then the fact that it's braided means that strands of polyester are taken and they're kind of woven together to create a very strong but man-made fibre. The Lin cable thread is made from linen, and linen itself, if you don't know, is made from flax, which is a plant. So in other words, the material itself here is a natural material. This is what's known as cable linen. You can see it says Lin cable, or however that's pronounced, on there. And what that means is that linen strands are taken, they are twisted together, and then those twisted strands are retwisted together to create what's known as cable linen. So in the way that this is polyester strands braided together, this is linen strands braided or cabled together. Some linen threads are more just twisted together rather than being cable linen, which aren't quite up to the standard of this. That's why this is actually one of the best threads that you can get in terms of the linen threads. And what you've got between these two threads is very much the best really in terms of the two camps. So this being a modern thread made from a man-made material, this being a more traditional kind of thread made from a natural material. There are obviously other brands of thread out there apart from these two, but you will find that they fall kind of into these two camps of being, man-made materials or natural materials, and the style that that gives you. So the second thing to talk about is the strength. All threads have an inherent strength in terms of a breaking strain, if you like, similar to like fishing line or something would have, in that if you put, X pounds of pressure on a length of that, then at some point it's gonna snap. That would be like the breaking strain of it. So it's important that we know that the product is strong, but what we also worry about is the wear of the thread. Because if you think about it, there's lots of holes when you make a leather item. We pull the thread through the first hole, and then that thread goes in and out and in and out and in and out. And across a big length of thread, it can go in and out many, many times before that bit of the end of the thread is itself caught up in the item. There's friction on there and that wears the thread. Both of these threads are strong. You would struggle to snap any thickness of tiger thread by hand. The thinner cable linens you would probably manage to snap by hand. The slightly thicker ones are again very, very strong. But what you would find is that in use, the linen thread will wear more as it's actually stitched with. So if you stitch in a long run, you may find that you start to fray and wear the thread a little bit as you get down to the end of your piece of thread. And that's generally when snappages will occur. So the braided polyester thread, again, is very strong tension-wise, but also it doesn't wear really in that way when it's used. So even across a very long run, as you're stitching, when you get to the end of that stitching run and you've only got a little bit of thread left, that thread at the end won't really look worn and like it's about to fray and snap. So those are the two kinds of strength there, but certainly both of these threads are very strong because of the nature in which they're woven together. Okay, so number three is the sizes that are available of these threads. So tiger thread is sold in metric sizes. The smallest size that you can get is 0.6 millimeters, and then it goes up in small increments. So you get a 0.6, a 0.8, a 1 millimeter, a 1.2, a 1.4, and then a 1.7. For the purposes of general leather goods, I've never used anything bigger than a millimeter. Millimeter tiger thread is very, very strong. I don't think you'd need to jump up to the bigger sizes unless you were making very large, heavy items, perhaps such as luggage, or if you were perhaps getting into, horse things, saddles and bridles and things like that, which needed a lot more strength. Certainly for small kinds of leather goods like you'll have seen me make, I don't use really anything above a millimetre. The sizes of the cable linen aren't so easy to understand. Let me just read these off the sheet so I don't get them wrong. So we have an 8.32, a 6.32, a 5.32, a 4.32 and a 3.32. The 8.32, the larger number, is the smallest thread. That's equivalent to 0.43 millimetres. The 3.32 is the largest, and that's equivalent to 0.77 millimetres. Now what I do have, if you go on my website, you go to the leather section, the general help section, come down to the threads, what you will find is all the sizes of the cable linen in there in millimetres, which you can easily compare to other thread sizes. So what does that mean? Well, that means that depending on the goods that you're making may dictate one or the other of these. So the cable linen, which is very nice thread, goes down to a really nice small size at 0.43 millimetres. That's a very fine thread. So if you're making extremely fine leather goods and you're getting into small things like dainty watch straps or smaller goods such as that, and you want a very fine thread that looks very refined, especially with a small SPI, so if you start stitching at 10, 12 or even above stitches per inch, you want a very fine thread to go with that, and that's where this excels in that smaller thread. The maximum size this goes to, as I say, is 0.77 millimetres, so that's going to be very close to the 0.8 tiger thread. If you want to stitch heavier leather goods, so you may be making something like a knife sheath or a holster or something like that, and you're thinking more like a 1 millimetre tiger thread would work, then again, the maximum size in this doesn't really go up to those sizes. So what you want really is the choice, between. And that's really partly what this video is about, is that it's not a case of, this one's better than this one or vice versa. It's that they do different tasks. They look good in different circumstances. They have different strengths and weaknesses. Okay, so let's have a closer look on the table now at some of the other aspects of these threads. Okay, so for number four, let's talk about colour choice next. So first of all, with the Fio Chinois, there's a really nice ranges of colours. This is one of the big advantages to these for me, is that they've got some really, really kind of classic, stylish looking colours, which really appeal to me for certain types of leather goods. So if you're making, if you're making something very functional, like a knife sheath or something like that, generally it doesn't need, a very fancy colour. It's going to be an earth tone kind of a colour, such as a black or a brown generally. Once you get into smaller leather goods, or sometimes what people call fine leather work in these days, whatever that means, for example, fancy handbags, purses, wallets,
watch straps, little things like that. You may sometimes want a more classic kind of a colour, especially if you're complementing a particularly strongly coloured leather, which you may be with handbags and things, for example. So what I've got here is a little selection of colours of Fio Chinois, and I'm not going to go through every one of these because, of course, you can look at the colour chart on the website if you want to. But you can see that what we've got is some nice traditional kind of earth tones, and earth tones are what I would call matched colours for leather, for natural kind of leathers. If you're working with veg tan leather, then often, especially if you're dyeing it yourself, it's going to end up in either some kind of shade of brown, you know, going from tans to mid-browns to dark browns, right through to blacks, so that kind of spectrum. And you know, to go with that, you generally want different, you know, different sorts of browns. So we've got a lighter brown there, a little bit more of a medium brown. You've got neutral colours, which are kind of blacks and grey shades. Again, you may want a you know, a purely black thread like that one there, or something off black into a grey. And then what we'll be left with when we take colours out are the more classic styles of colours. They remind me of kind of colours of fancy paint and things like that. So we have some sort of really nice blues and greens. You can see the colour names of some of these on there. Jade, there, and so on. So we've got nice blues, nice greens. These kind of colours, these look very nice. And then you've got various different purples. Again, even the purples look quite nice there if you're looking for a sort of, you know, royal kind of a colour. So there's an example of those there. And as I say, you can look at the full range on the website. So if we talk about the colours that are available of Tiger Thread, that's quite an interesting topic because, as far as I know, Julius Koch themselves make quite a big range of colours. I once found on, I think it was an Italian website, buried somewhere, a kind of colour chart on there for Tiger Thread colours. And there were, you know, there were quite a lot of colours. So I've never seen another website where they have a range of colours that's any better than Abbey's. But Abbey's range is then limited to a kind of a dozen colours or something like that. So if there are companies out there who sell all these other colours of Tiger Thread that are available, I honestly don't know where they are. So in terms of the colours that are available, first of all, there's a decent range of, again, the earth tone style colours. So things ranging from black to white and then in a kind of brown spectrum. So you've got your sort of tans, mid-browns, and dark browns, those kind of a colours. And then what are also available are some sort of bright colours as well. So for example, a yellow, an orange, a red, that's I think that was called beetroot or something. It's kind of a darkish purple. But to me, in terms of comparing these, the brighter colours rather than the earth tones, not only is the selection not as nice, but these just don't have quite the same classy look to them. Okay, so number five, let's talk about the appearance of the thread. Now, cable linen thread is very much round in profile, okay, and that's to do with the way that it's braided together. So it has pretty much a circular profile. That means that when you stitch with it, it gives it a particular look. The look keeps it kind of narrow looking compared to its size. It also means that it stands up a little bit off the surface of the leather more. And that's assuming that you're not stitching in a channel. Now that's a whole separate topic, but generally if you're making sort of fine leather goods, you aren't going to be trying to gouge out any kind of a stitching channel. You would maybe press in just with a mark. So if you think about the surface of the leather like this, there may be a small indentation where you've made a mark, and then you're laying your threads down and you're hammering them into that channel. That's different to the approach of actually gouging a channel out of the leather with you know, a stitch groover, which isn't something you would be doing on wallets, fine handbags, watch straps or anything such as that. So because this is round, it tends to sit a little bit more proud than the Tiger Thread would, obviously unless it's really small and then it flattens down, but also the round appearance keeps it fine looking, and we'll look at that in a moment. The Tiger Thread is, that will be difficult to draw, but it's almost like it's a little bit flatter. It's kind of like, I suppose, more like a tape. So if we imagine it maybe kind of, I suppose, a little bit more like that kind of a shape on the side. So it's not perfectly round. It's almost a bit wider than it is tall, if you like. And what that means is that when we stitch with that one, again, if we've got a kind of shallow indentation, because it's that little bit smaller, it tends to lay that little bit flatter against the leather, so it flattens out nicely. However, that also means that it tends to, for size by size comparison, it tends to look not quite so fine as the linen threads. If we use some 0.6 linen, some 0.6 tiger thread, the tiger thread would look a little bit fatter in appearance once it's actually been stitched with. And I'll put a little photo on the video as a side-by-side comparison so you can see what I mean about that. So again, this is really partly just a choice, but if you put them side by side, you may decide that you prefer the look of one over the other. Certainly the tiger thread can be a little bit more robust looking, the cable linen can be a little bit more fine looking. Okay, so number six is ease of threading. Now, let's bring that back in a moment. Because of the different shapes of these, I find personally, tiger thread is easier to thread than cable linen, because if you think about it, when you do your needle threading, your needle has to pass straight through the middle of the thread. The kind of flat appearance of this means that the needle very easily catches on this flat bit here, goes straight through, no problems, no frustration. Because the cable linen is round, as you put the needle on and try and pierce this, it's often a tendency to kind of want to slip off to the side. And that makes it a little bit more difficult. Okay, so number seven is the wax content of the thread. Now, both of these threads are waxed from the factory. However, they're waxed to different degrees and they don't really feel the same. So tiger thread is, I would say, very, very well waxed in terms of it's got just the right amount in, is what I mean by that. It feels waxy to the touch. You can see, for example, if I pull it out straight, it almost stands out straight on its own. You know, that's the wax helping that to do that, giving it structure. It doesn't feel too waxed. And I know sometimes, you know, if people try and copy these threads, that's one of the things that really struggle to copy is the wax content. This is, I would say, perfectly waxed. It's always just right. The wax in a thread like this, because this is man-made, it doesn't necessarily need wax in order to protect the thread in the way that a natural one does, where you're wanting to, you know, keep it from rotting, keep it from getting broken down. Because this is polyester, it's not going to break down, I don't think, really without the wax on. But what the wax does do is it gives weight to the thread, which is something we'll talk about in a minute. It gives it a lot more kind of weight and structure. It helps in order to tension your stitching. So when you pull your stitching up tight, the fact that it's waxed helps it kind of grab and bind against itself, especially when you know you've cast inside the leather. It helps with threading the needles in that it keeps everything nicely kind of smushed together. Instead of being, you know, woolly and fibery, it's very much, you know, easy to pass through a needle and so on. So it's still very beneficial having the wax in there. And it does obviously add extra protection to the thread as well. The Fio Chinois thread is also a waxed thread. It specifically says on the website that it's a waxed thread. However, it does not feel waxy to me. And I've heard people refer to it as being internally waxed, whatever that means. So I think they kind of add wax during the manufacturing process, but then due to the way that it's braided round or whatever, it doesn't seem to end up with a lot of surface wax, if you like. So it doesn't have a waxy feel by default, but there is some wax in there. But what you can do, of course, is simply add more wax if you want. So you take a block of beeswax, which is traditional, you take off your length of thread, and then you simply prepare your thread by repeatedly pulling it over the beeswax until you've added the extra wax content that you require. And depending on the item that you're making, you obviously have that choice. You can stay with the kind of default wax that's in there, or you can add a bit more wax if you want to give it that bit more protection or that bit more rigidity, or, you know, to your liking. So that gives you the choice. Okay, so number eight is the ease of stitching then. How easy is it to actually stitch with these threads? For me, the tiger thread is a lot easier to use in terms of the actual stitching. And I think, I was thinking about that before I started the video, I think the reason for that is the fact that it's essentially got more structure to it. So again, if I pull out this piece of thread here and I just pull it taut with my finger and thumb, you can see that almost like a magic trick, it's standing horizontally out like that. There's nothing supporting that thread at all other than the content of the thread, but it's, you know, it's stuck straight out without me doing anything else to it. The cable linen, as I say, unwaxed, doesn't. It's kind of floppy. So if I pull, you know, if I pull this out, it drops and it hits. It doesn't have that structure. What that means is when you're dealing with a big length of thread is that this has a tendency to kind of just flop around a bit more. You know, when you're stitching with this and when you're casting it over, it feels like it kind of goes where you direct it in terms of your fingers and your needles. When you cast it, it very kind of positively casts over, and that means that in terms of loops and knots and the continuity of your stitching, it just seems to behave itself, if that makes sense. The Fio Chinois, it's got a sort of, it's a little bit more floaty, do you know what I mean? It wants to loop round, it wants to kink, it wants to drop in the wrong place. And to me, that means when I'm stitching with it, I just tend to wrestle with it a little bit more in terms of putting it where it needs to be. But I think if you were to use this day in, day out, you would probably just get used to that.
Okay, so number 9 is the price difference. Now, undeniably, the cable linen is quite a lot more expensive than the tiger thread. Rather than giving you specific prices, because obviously people watch this from all around the world, I worked this out earlier on the prices that I could buy it for, and ultimately the cable linen is around 3 times the price per meter of the tiger thread. So there's a, you know, they're not even closely comparable. This is just very much more expensive. What you do have to bear in mind with thread though is, although it looks expensive, it does tend to last a long time. Unless you're running, you know, an actual, like a very, you know, a large business or a factory or something like that. If you're just buying thread to use yourself in a hobby capacity, or, you know, you're making a few items to sell, a roll of thread is going to last you a long time, really. So although the initial outlay may seem like a lot, once you buy these things and invest in them, it's not like the week after you're going to be going out and replacing that thread. Okay, so the final thing, number 10, is the availability of these threads. How easy is it to actually get hold of these threads? Now let's talk about tiger thread first of all. I made a video about hand stitching leather several years ago now, and I talked about tiger thread in that video. And what I said in the video is that tiger thread's great, but it's very difficult to get hold of. Now, at the time when I made that video, tiger thread was very difficult to get hold of. There were no people selling tiger thread at Amazon or on eBay or on Etsy or in the entire United States of America. And it was, you know, it's not an easy thing to find at that time. After I made that video, I started selling tiger thread in short sections on my Etsy shop. You know, she could come and buy sample lengths, get different colours, see what you wanted. And following me doing that, a lot of other people, whether it's because of me or not, I don't know, but suspiciously, after that time, a lot of other people started doing the same thing. They were then selling on Amazon, they were selling on eBay, they were selling on Etsy, and so on. And then again, companies in America then also started to sell. So in other words, it's not actually difficult now to find tiger thread if you want to use it. There's shops in America which will sell you bits or full reels, or there's various other shops and places on the internet, on Amazon and other places, which will sell you tiger thread, so that has changed. And people do like to leave comments on the old video saying, yeah, but you know, tiger thread's available all over the place. Believe me, at the point where that video was made, it wasn't. So the availability of cable linen isn't a problem at all. As I say, you can buy this direct from Maison Sajou in France. They will ship worldwide. Obviously, it costs a lot, and obviously, if you buy from France and you're not in the EU, you're then going to be paying import charges and so on. To be honest, in the UK, we might be paying import charges from France soon because of Brexit. That's a whole different matter. You can buy this from any resellers that you can find who sell this. There will be, again, there's companies in America who I presume just bulk buy this from France and then sell on within the US. So this isn't difficult to find if you want to use it. Okay, so I hope you found that video useful. Just a little bit of extra information around those, because I know there's sometimes a little bit of mystique. And I know especially if you're a new leather worker and you're looking at sort of, you know, somebody very established work, and they're saying, oh, I've made this with, you know, affiliation Chinois or something, you think, you know, what's that? Where can I get it? There's often a little bit of mystery to these things, and you just want to sort of get the info, to get the lowdown on these, which is what this has tried to be. Okay, so I hope that's useful, and I'll see you in the next video.